Welcome to the podcast. We have Jim Willis here. Hi, Jim.
Hi, how are you?
Good, doing great. I'm so excited to have you here.
Well, thank you. It's good to be with you.
Yeah. So just to let everyone know a little bit about you, Jim Willis, kind of the starting point of this is Jim Willis is the author of The Quantum Akashic Field, A Guide to Out-of-Body Experiences for the Astral Traveler. So I know that's a mouthful and a mindful. And just a little bit of background about Jim. Jim is retired from ministry and teaching and has moved into the quiet woods. But a little bit about more about him is he is a theologian, a historian, musician. He earned his master's degree from Andover Newton Theological School and has been an ordained minister for over 40 years, now retired. He served as an adjunct college professor in the field of comparative religion and cross-cultural education. He was the host of his own Drive Time radio show. You have a great voice for it, so I could see that.
Thank you.
And a guest lecturer on historical studies and contemporary spirituality. His background in theology and education led to his writing more than a dozen books on religion, the apocalypse, cross-cultural spirituality, and arcane or buried cultures, specializing in research bridging lost civilizations, suppressed history, and the study of earth energy, dowsing, and out-of-body experiences. We'll definitely do some defining of that. What I really love is, especially through this book, The Quantum Akashic Field, outlines a modern scientific way to understand the deep reality in which we live and move, but a process of getting in touch with that reality. So it's an understanding and the process of getting in touch with that reality, that deep reality. Life can seem hard at times, Jim says, but his hope is that this book will help make life a little easier. So I really thank you for joining us here.
Oh, glad to be with you.
Yeah. Is there anything I left out?
No, you made me sound so interesting, Stephanie. Thank you.
Well, you are.
I appreciate it.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to sit here with you. And as I was saying, what I love about this conversation is it's so interesting to me because you come from this theological background. I grew up Catholic. I don't identify as Catholic now, but what I can see is what's so interesting to me is everything that you're talking about, out-of-body experiences, the Akashic field, a lot of these things, we're just going to get right into it. A lot of these things, they seem to be something that someone coming from a Christian background can be fearful of or think that it has to be separate from. And people who I work with who want to get into, who start to have intuitive experiences, who are connecting with these guides that are in the sort of Akashic field, spirit guides, soul guides, they're afraid of how people will judge them coming from that background. So how on earth did you go from being a minister to just this is what you embrace? I mean, there's so much depth to what you do, which we're going to get into, but tell us about that bridge.
Well, I didn't expect it when I came here. In the Christian ministry, as I'm assumed in ministry in any leadership roles in any major world religion, it's amazing how far we have moved away from the initial vision of the founders, Moses, Muhammad, Jesus, Buddha, Confucius, Lao Tzu, all of them. They had, if you go back and study how it began, every single one of them had a spiritual experience, which I believe was a shamanic experience. It was being in touch with the other side.
Yeah. So when you say shamanic, just for people who like this is new to them, like what do you mean by that?
40,000 years ago, or maybe even 60,000 years ago, something changed in our species. The early visionaries went into the great painted caves in Western Europe. And they began to paint visions on the wall. I believe these to be visions that they had had of the other side. I believe they had out of body experiences. And they began to paint those pictures. It was the beginning of religion. It was the beginning of symbolic thinking, of trying to put into language or into art the visions that we see when we escape the reality of that fivefold sense of the offense of the senses that are around us, of touch and taste and hearing and sight and smell. And these early, they didn't call themselves shamans. That's the name that we give them. We can call them religious leaders, you can call them spiritual visionaries, gurus. I think they discovered the reality that exists outside those senses and were trying to put it into some kind of form that would communicate to the people of around them, the people of their tribe, the people of their family. And I think the same thing happened with all of the people who began the great religions that we have in the world today. Yeah. They had this shamanic or otherworldly experience. They saw through the illusion of what we call reality. That fivefold fence surrounds us, and it's valuable because the senses reveal a lot to us about what we're seeing, but they also have a tendency to filter out a lot because we just simply couldn't handle all that information.
Right.
And they had that vision. I think the problem is in religion that that vision was then interpreted by the followers, and they built the what I call the religions around that central experience. I sometimes wonder if Muhammad or Jesus or Moses were to come back today and look at what we've done, I think they kind of shake their heads and say, "No, this isn't what I had in mind."
I mean, I have some ideas about that too. Just as we talk about shamanic, to wrap our minds around this, like you're so in it, right? It's like to step out for someone who's new to this to understand it. I mean, I look at those who have. It's almost, to me, it's like a quote unquote awakening or seeing beyond the physical. And I think our prefrontal cortex wants us to put things into baskets. We want things to be neat and organized black and white. And so when people created these texts and created these structures, they definitely were very hierarchical. Mm-hmm. They helped people control people. And if everybody was able to access all of this awakened experience, then that could be very fearful to these leaders who were benefiting monetarily and in power by having, not necessarily these awakened leaders, but the political leaders,
right,
so to speak.
Right. And that's, it goes way back. If you go back into the Bible, for instance, if you are either a Muslim or a Jew or a Christian, you go back into the Bible and you find someone like Isaiah, a revered prophet of all three religions. You read the first chapter of his book. He had a shamanic out-of-body experience. There's no question about it. It was a typical example of the shaman who was in the spirit, who saw the vision, who was taken out of body, taken up to a different place. He saw figures that he couldn't quite describe because it was beyond language. Human people with animal heads and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And he tried to put it. He received a message, which is what shamans do, a message of either healing or hope or whatever. Mm-hmm. He received a message and he came back to the people. That's a classic shamanic experience in the book of Isaiah. And yet he was rejected by his people.
Right.
They wouldn't listen to it either. I'm sure that the very first shaman who went into that great cave in Western Europe and came out and came back to his tribe. And I'm sure after he delivered his message, somebody went home to the cave and said, "Honey, you won't believe what this guy's gone over the deep end."
The
Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians, "I had an out-of-body experience."
Right.
I don't know why it's so frightful. Exactly, except that people have just, as you say, they've bought into the whole political hierarchical thing, and we've made it, we've taken out of our religion probably the central thing that began it in the first place.
Yeah, and I think it's like a centralization of power, right? Like we are these lights that have our own power. Like for instance, for me personally, in my own journey of awakening to my intuition that was always there, it's interesting because when you talk about some of these things, like the out-of-body experience, like when I'm doing a reading for an individual or a group or individuals within a group, I can visualize being in this channel and certain certain beings will come to me sometimes, like that archetypal half human, half, yes. You know, I sort of think of like an Egyptian one, or I'm not an expert in the angels. However, the angels will tell me their name to be, to give to someone, so that message can be interpreted for them, or letting them know like that is the angel that's there with them for a certain thing or time. And sometimes, you know, it's a past loved one that comes through. So you know, it's interesting because when you talk about the next thing, I kind of, there's like so much, you know, so much to talk about. Like one, to me, the shaman, to me, you can be an everyday shaman. And to me, what that means is we understand that everything is energy. We understand we are connected to a much greater source, and we are able to kind of shift energy, direct energy, heal through energy. And the shamans were somehow given these downloads or come to understand them. And so through these variety of methods that shamans have, they are able to help people, you know, grasp or work through a past trauma, like see the bigger picture, even heal, you know, through that, the mind body experience. So to me, I mean, you consider yourself a shaman. So, you know, let me know from your perspective, like that's how I'm sort of defining shaman, but I'm curious about like, what does that mean to you?
Well, I don't know if I can really consider myself a shaman. I don't think I can use the term, because in traditional shamanic cultures, the shaman is the last one to know. It's always the people around him or her that knows. But I certainly honor that tradition, honor that title, and I certainly aspire to it.
Right.
I think what happened was that we are living in a time of history when what we're talking about, what you just described, used to be commonplace.
Yes.
And then we got, you know, in the ancient ones, and then we got into all of this separation of so-called science and religion. It probably needed to happen, because it was being abused certainly by the church. But it's time to come back together again and realize there is no difference. Anything that you've just described has what we could call a scientific underlayment, except that we just don't understand that kind of science yet, largely because we close ourselves off to it. I think it's all one. I really do.
Well, what's interesting about that is it's like sometimes you know these things, and then something, you know, through synchronicities, like what you're meant to know next, it becomes available to you. And, you know, without getting into too much detail, there's this microfrequency device that I became aware of about a year and a half ago. And when I got it, when I began to research it, like it like blew the lid off of these things that I knew to be true, but then they were quantified through science, through the quantum field, through talking about the quantum field. Like to me, there is science behind some of this. I mean, without getting into the weeds about that, because I don't want to get off. I mean, it is on track. but the part I want to talk about with you too, for people who may struggle with this concept, like what is an out-of-body experience? Are we all having these? When I talk about being in the channel, is that an out-of-body experience? Like I'm in my body. I'm also accessing things that are not three-dimensional.
Yeah. I think I can safely and unequivocally say, I don't know. I don't know. You know, one of the reasons I talk about out-of-body experience in a book called The Quantum Akashic Field is because in quantum reality, we're starting to, we're just babies in it. We've only been there 100 years, but in that quantum reality, I think is the beginnings of understanding the science. When we talk, a central part of quantum reality is the idea of entanglement, that everything is connected. Mm-hmm. And so when we go out of body, are we really going out of body, or are we just becoming aware of the fact that we are connected to something that is outside of our perception realm.
Yeah.
I don't know if we actually leave. We can get into all kinds of semantics about the difference between etheric travel and, you know, the astral travel, you know, and all those mm-hmm. kinds of things. Mm-hmm. So I don't really know. All I know is that when we come back from that kind of a vision that you just described, mm-hmm. We're faced with a real problem, and that's trying to find the language to describe it, because our language was invented to describe what happens on the inside of our perception fence, the reality that we see and touch and taste. Mm-hmm. And now we're trying to describe something that is totally different. So we can't say this is what it is. All we can do is say this is what it is. This is what it seemed like.
Right.
And when we go in, for instance, when we see one of these spirit guides who perhaps, you know, I've seen them, I'm sure you have too, of a human body with some kind of an animal head or a hybrid of some sort, you find them throughout the Bible. They're always described. I think what happens is we are seeing something that is real, something that is based in a reality that's beyond ours, beyond our perception realm anyway, I mean. And then we can't say, well, this is what I saw. All we can say is what I saw looked like this. And that little Rolodex of experience we all have in our minds as we get older, goes through all kinds of stuff and tries to find the nearest picture to it.
Right.
And then we come back. And it can sound pretty fantastic. Mm-hmm. Some of these things can sound fantastic. But at the time, you've noticed, I'm sure, when you're experiencing, it doesn't seem fantastic at all. It seems more real than reality. Mm-hmm. And yet when we try to describe it, that's where it sounds weird. So people have said, you know, do you go somewhere or do you just experience what is there because you are entangled with it, so to speak? Mm-hmm. I honestly don't know what the answer is. And the more I go on, the less I care what the answer is. The important thing is experiencing it.
Right. Well, what to you is important about, well, let's back up. Okay. Cause I'm going to ask you more about out of body experiences, but I want to kind of back up to what is this quantum Akashic field? Like, I've heard of the quantum field and the Akashic records. Mm-hmm. And to me, when I heard about the Akashic records, to me, it seems like the quantum field. So, but you've combined them. So how do you describe that space?
I see the quantum reality in existing, undergirding everything, really. And when I talk about Akasha, I'm using the term, for instance, that Laszlo used when he went back to use the Sanskrit term, wonderful spiritual language, Sanskrit. Mm-hmm. He used the word Akashic field because Akasha is everything. It's that place of infinite possibility, infinite probability. And I don't see it being out there. I see it, we are in effect crystallized in it.
Yes.
We are simply, you know, between us and the Akashic field, there is the newly discovered Higgs field, that place where energy gains matter.
How do you spell that?
Higgs, H-I-G-G-S.
Okay.
Discovered, it was first of all theorized by Peter Higgs, the Scottish, in Scotland. Mm-hmm. Who just paper and pencil and calculator figured out what this had to be. There had to be this Akashic field. And lo and behold, in his lifetime, he never expected it, but he was flown over to CERN in Switzerland, and certain enough, the great particle collider over there discovered it. The Higgs field.
Yeah.
And when you try to ask a physicist, what is the Higgs field? Usually they just kind of laugh. It's very difficult. Over here in America, they're tempted to say, well, it's, you know, Einstein told us that energy equals mass times the speed of light squared. Energy, mass, two different, you know, they're the same thing. And energy comes through this Akashic field, which is now a scientific reality, the Higgs field rather. And over here, it tends to what they call slow down and gain mass.
Yeah.
Here in America, they talk about it being like syrup or something like that, that kind of goos up and slows you up.
Right.
Over in England, they talk about treacle. They use the same kind of idea, molasses over here. Mm-hmm. But whatever it is, it's there on the other side, and it is energy, and that is slowed down enough to be able to form mass. And that's what we are.
Right.
And we are simply energy. And if you look, you know, the closer you look down and down and down into the human body until you get to, you know, cells and particles, certain mm-hmm. enough, there we are. We're just mm-hmm. seething masses of energy that have taken on this mass for a purpose.
Right. That's where, you know, when I talk about this particular device, it might be interesting for you to look it up or just as well. It's called the Healy and the inventor.
Yes. I did a podcast with him once a couple of years ago.
Oh my gosh, are you serious?
Yeah.
I can't wait. With Marcus Schmicke?
Well, pardon me?
With Marcus Schmicke, with the inventor?
With one of the, I can't think of the name right now. Somebody very closely associated with it, and his name just escapes me.
That's so great. That's okay.
It was one of his family has been producing these things for two generations now.
Yeah.
It's fun. Yeah.
Right.
And so it was a lot of fun. We really had a good time.
Well, it's so great. Cause everything that you're talking about, this is where, you know, the Healy, for instance, is working at that level of, you know, of we are energy, we are molecules, we are mm-hmm. cells. And so we can literally calibrate to our optimal well-being with that cell through frequency. We can match with that. And one thing you were talking about with this Higgs, like if I put it into like more simple terms that I understand, you know, the Higgs field, the Akash, like I look at an example of when I'm connecting or when someone's wanting to connect with their soul guides, with a past loved one, the way I understand it is those past loved ones, those soul guides, we envision them the way we can, which is very tangibly, you know, with matter mm-hmm. and space, how we would see them. However, mm-hmm. they are more just energy, like a cloud, like think of like mm-hmm. a cloud, right? It's just like, they're just like less mass. They're not dense. The way we are. And mm-hmm. so when we are connecting, that's why it can help to ohm. That's why it can help to perhaps get out your crystals. It can help to, you know, expand your convergent vision because you are getting into a less dense space. And so, so our guides, sometimes they give us images that I tell people, you have to give yourself time to dive deeper because the first image you might get, like one of my best examples is, in communication with my grandmother, she gave me the image of a hamburger. And I was like, we never really even ate hamburgers. Why are you giving me, why is this coming through? Mm-hmm. And as I dove deeper in channel writing and writing what was just coming through with her, what she was really showing me was food. She was showing mm-hmm. me something really tangible. Like, what can I give you? I can give you this image of a hamburger. It's so mm-hmm. tangible. And then through that came the message about family, about community. You know, there was a deeper message. I just needed to take the time with it. So I think sometimes because we are so dense that to connect, we're going to be given something that it's going to start out like the color green or like a pen, but that's going to have like a metaphor or a, you know, something mm-hmm. deeper to it that we can understand because we are so dense. Yeah. We have these senses we work with. So that's how we're going to interpret. That's going to be the language we can use is through our sensory experience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine what it would have been like to try to communicate and break through with a meaningful way with someone like Helen Keller, who could not see or could not hear?
You amazing, have
no,
right?
And never could. So there's no common ground. She was unable to experience anything that we have. Now mm-hmm. these people on the other side are trying to get through to us and we are deaf and we are blind in so many ways. Yeah. When I was a minister, of course, many times I'd be called to the hospital bed of someone who's dying. Mm-hmm. And I can't tell you the number of times I've sat there and held the hand of someone and was with them and talking to them or praying with them when they died and when they flatlined and mm-hmm. the nurses and the doctors rushed in, pushed me out of the room. And then once in a while, about six or eight times in 40 years that I remember, the person came back and they always talked to me about the same thing. First of all, I had never seen anybody who went crossed over and wanted to come back. They always wanted to stay, but they knew they had mm-hmm. to come back. The other thing though was that they would describe seeing somebody. Sometimes they would talk about an angel or a being mm-hmm. of light or sometimes a loved one. Mm-hmm. And at the time, you have no idea how ashamed of myself, because at the time I didn't accept any of this. And I was a minister and I didn't accept any of this. And so I never said, oh, no, you don't understand. Your brain is shutting down and the blood isn't circulating to certain areas. And you were just imagining that, you know.
Right.
I never said that to them. Of course, I would say, oh, isn't that nice? Now I'm kicking myself because I realize I was in the presence of someone who had left this perception realm, gone on to that place of less dense realm, saw something, came back and tried to tell me about it. And rather than accept it and learn from it, I dismissed it. Oh, I'm so ashamed of myself. You have no idea. One of the great, great problems I have with my life. But at any rate,
well, you know, the beauty though is, to be honest, I mean, I love having this conversation with you, because as I mentioned, I come from a Catholic background that in my conversations, in my experience with people in that religion, we can't have this conversation, this conversation, you know, there, and what's so interesting to me, there are so many parallels, but in any case, you know, when I think about like regret, I also think about those people who maybe at this point who they came back, maybe they now have passed, you know, that you can talk to them. Like for whatever regrets, you can be like, you can tell them like, look, I'm so sorry. And they know,
they know.
And the beauty is, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, I've had the wonderful experience three different times in the last 12 years since I've started having out of body experiences. I've had the wonderful experience of being able to find someone who was confused, who hadn't really understood that they had died and that it was time for them to go on, and they didn't know how to go on. And so they were in effect stuck in this kind of reality. And three times I've had the wonderful privilege of being able to lead them through to the light. And it just, it is such a freeing thing. I don't want to say they were trapped here for any length of time, because I don't think time exists for them.
Right.
Time is on this side of our perception fence. But but they just didn't know where to go or what to do. And they were confused.
It reminds me of this great movie. I have little kids. So we watched the movie Soul. I don't know if you watched that movie. And it's like the sign twirler and then the hippie woman. And they help the people cross over. Like that guy. I love that movie because it's like it gets it. But I'm curious to you, like, why someone gets stuck, and if that's what people experience when they, you know, experience an entity in a room or like a ghost, for instance, like, are they experiencing people who got stuck or confused or didn't have that person to help guide them over? Or like, what's the deal with that?
It could very well be. My wife and I were called in. One of our neighbors came to us one afternoon, and she said, can you go to my son's house? Because he and his wife and their daughter are over here. They're staying with me. They won't go back to their house. There's something going on. And we said, yeah, we'll do it tomorrow. So she came over the next day, and I had her sit down and draw a diagram of the house where the rooms were and everything else to get it kind of set up. Yeah. I got my pendulum out and kind of doused it. And then we went over there together, and I went to this place. It was a town I've never been in before. And it was a little house, goes way back, long, you know, built quite some time ago. And as I doused it, I realized it was on the house was built on the crossing place of two energy lines, very powerful energy with a vortex right in the middle of the house. And so I went in with my dowsing rods and began to contact, and immediately was in contact with entities that were there. And I couldn't understand, except all I had was this wonderful feeling of peace and joy from these entities. Well, later on, I found out who it was, doing a little research, discovered that back in the days of Jim Crow, this white young woman had fallen in love with a black man. And back then, they just couldn't do that. And here in South Carolina, anyway. And the black man was lynched, and he was hung, murdered. The woman grieved for the rest of her life. She stayed right there in the same house, wouldn't leave. And after she died, they were reunited. And their energies were right there. And so as I began to talk to these, I said, do you need any help going on? No, we're perfectly happy. We're together. We're right here. This is where we want to be. And I wasn't about to do that bell, book and candle. Oh, be gone. And
right.
You know, so I just said, well, it's great that you're happy. I think it's tremendous. Just, you know, hold it down a little. You're scaring the little girl. And they said, okay. That was the last of the problem. There was no more problem.
Right. Yes. I love it. So I think what this really opens up is for anyone who is sort of having some energy shifts or quote unquote weirdness in their homes, mm-hmm. You can talk to these spirits. Like we can conversations. You can set your boundaries for people who are really open, who are getting a lot of communication at night. If you're not into that, like you're like, I need to sleep. You know, you can set your boundaries. It's just that mm-hmm. If you are an open person, that spirit's going to just be, you know, it's like you get it. Yes, I can talk to you.
You know, we can do that. And I think we should do that. I think our problem is that it's very difficult for us in this particular culture. I'm sure you've experienced it so much. People just don't want to accept it. And it's so difficult for us to actually say, this is what's going on, because we've got all of this teaching saying, oh no, that's, you know, that's of the devil, or you're just imagining it, or whatever.
I feel like a shift in my, you know, listen, so I live in Southern California, but also, I mean, you know, there's a lot of people, as a mom, I cannot talk to other moms about this kind of stuff. I have found a beautiful niche, a beautiful sisterhood of women who are totally into all of this. And we have great conversations. Yeah. And, because I am an intuitive, this is what I do. And so my world, like my bubble is very much all about this stuff all the time. Mm-hmm. So I'm not really encountering those people who think I'm crazy, because they're just not in my field.
I don't blame. It's and that can be really healthy. I think it's wonderful.
However, I've talked to people, women who have come into like my membership, who they live in a very conservative place and they felt really scared to put themselves out there. The beauty is, because we have the online sphere, you might have people all around you who are like, sure, there's no way. Maybe there's an inkling, but they would never say it out loud right now.
Yeah. That's why what you're doing is so important. Mm-hmm. You're opening this kind of up. It really is wonderful. I noticed the same thing growing up. I read about Jesus healing this person, healing that person. Mm-hmm. And yet nobody expects that spiritual healing is possible. I had an episode where a group of wise women who live in an energy field around which we built a medicine wheel down below our house, a group of wise women once healed my ankle. I had a broken ankle and they healed it. And I can't hardly tell anybody about that, because people say, you're nuts, you know?
Well, that's, you see, that to me, this to me is like the Healy, for instance, that is something that's tangible, because it is, it's a thing. And to me, it's sort of the crossroads into the next level of medicine. And the more research that's done, there'll be more understanding and acceptance. Sure. And the next point of that, I mean, I know plenty of Reiki healers, energy healers who do this stuff all the time. It's just a matter of, how attuned is your frequency to it? Like, what have you grown up with? Where do you live? I mean, I do think we're getting closer and closer. But on that, I want to ask you about the dowsing. So can you explain, like, what is dowsing? How did you get involved with it?
I don't know. I never really believed in dowsing. I had seen people dowsing for water, you know, and I thought there were, in my case, there's basically three dowsing implements. Some people use a pendulum, some people, I'm more familiar with L rods, and some people use the old willow stick, you know. But basically what it is our bodies are constantly experiencing energies that are flowing through us that we're simply not aware of them.
Yes.
And what happens,
cell phones. I mean, it's cell phones.
Same. It was, you know, kind of like the old, black, for people who are, I'm revealing my age now, people who used to have the little black and white televisions with the rabbit ears on the top for the antenna. Yeah. And so you realize when you pick up the rabbit ears, if you move around a different part of the room, they pick up the energy and they put a picture on the screen.
Yeah.
Well, you didn't realize until you picked up those rabbit ears that those same thing, they didn't start to flow through the room when you picked up the rabbit ears. They were there all the time.
Right.
You just didn't know it. Mm-hmm. And you became, in effect, a dowsing rod to produce a picture on the screen when you stood in the right place and held them in the right way. Mm-hmm. And that's what dowsing rods do, really. They are simply an outward manifestation of what your body is experiencing, but you don't know it, you're experiencing them.
Is it sort of like a, I don't know, like a compass, sort of like you're
yeah, something,
you're finding the energy kind of pathway, you're finding.
Yeah. And you can even use them to communicate. In my case, when I use my L rods, for instance, I have a couple of entities who I can talk to. It never failed me with the dowsing rods. Mm-hmm. And I hold them in my hands. And if they cross, it's a yes. And if they just stay there, it's a no.
Right.
And if I'm talking to one person, they'll cross or they'll stay. Or if I'm talking to someone else, my own spirit guide, for instance, for a yes, both rods will swing to the right. So we're having like a three-way conversation between my spirit guide and a guide who I just call Gaia because I have not yet identified her.
Yeah.
And every once in a while, a third person will come in and they'll swing to the left. But you come to realize, you know, and I began to douse for water at first, but then I discovered earth energies and being able to use these to actually communicate with the other side. I know that spooks some people, but I just find it perfectly normal now.
Right. So I'm more familiar with the pendulum. Mm-hmm. And you know what's interesting, and also I teach people how to use their own bodies, you know, to sort of sort of like kinesiology, but mostly with their own intuition, but also getting that yes, getting that no, and then of course, you know, translating that. And then I think, you know, there's different ways people can do this. They can do it through pulling cards, they might do it through the pendulum, they might do it through their own muscle testing. Mm-hmm. At some point you know, maybe even begin to just literally, like, quote unquote, have the conversation. And I think that's where a lot of doubt can come in, because people think, well, is it just, I'm just talking to myself, I'm making that up, you know?
You can actually douse for questions to which you do not know the answer, get the answer and then look it up afterwards and discover that it was there. And to me, dowsing is still kind of a crutch for me. Yeah, but I think I'm beginning to get past it, because a lot of times now I'll know the answer before the rods even move.
Yeah. See, it's
even
more
before
like
the
a
question is over. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what I feel like happened with me. I started out more with maybe cards or even the pendulum. Mm-hmm. And it just was sort of, and it was already there quickly before I even needed to do. So, you know, then you start to trust it more, like that it's just kind of coming through. So I love that. You know, just in terms of talking about these different things, I mean, you know, a lot of what we're talking about is pretty esoteric. And I mean, people are, you know, just trying to make a living out there. I mean, why do you feel like it's important to engage with this kind of stuff or even talk about
it? I think it's more important than it's the most important thing. I think
I agree with you.
Yeah, I think if we start to engage in this, everything else that seems so terrifying now will disappear. It happened for me one night about 3 o'clock in the morning. I got a call from a nurse at the local hospital saying a good friend of mine who was a member of my church, a man by the name of Bradley, was not expected to live through the night. And she said, he's calling for you and he wants to know if you can get here. And I said, of course. So I got up, got on my clothes, get in my car, drove to the hospital in the middle of the night. And I walk in and here's my friend Bradley, and he's tied up to all kinds of tubes coming in and out, and needles going around and dials and all this kind of stuff. And he's there in his bed. To understand this guy, he was about 80 at the time, and he's a brilliant man. He had a doctorate. He had started a college, which now is still going, a full-fledged university. He was a tremendous community asset, held all kinds of community positions, great member of the church, member of the deacon board, and served communion and went to all the Bible studies and seminars that I did and everything else. You just couldn't ask for a more picturesque example of a life well lived. And so I didn't have to fool around with him because we were good friends. I didn't have to, you know, beat around the bush like everybody does when it comes to approaching death. And I said, I held his hand. I said, Bradley, are you ready to go? He immediately started crying. He said, Jim, I've done a lot. He said, I've had a good life and I've done a lot. And I'm not ashamed of any of that. But he said, the one thing I haven't done is prepare for this moment. And I said, oh, wow, Bradley. Well, we were lucky. He didn't die that night. He lasted for 10 more days. Mm-hmm. And I spent a good deal of those 10 days with him. I don't know whether I taught him anything in our conversations. I know he sure taught me a lot. Mm-hmm. But all I could think of is that Bradley began to epitomize for me the lives that most of us lead, which are just so busy and so hectic and so loud and and everything. Worried about all this stuff and trying to remember all the passwords and numbers and how to do this and how to handle the technology and where we have to be and when we have to be there. We do all of that, and we don't do the thing that's most important, and that's prepare for the moment when this body dies, and it will die. Everybody dies, and it comes time for us to cross over, actually to go not on, but to go back, I think, to where we came from and carry with us that lifetime of experience. I think we carry that into the Akashic Records. I mean, that's what the Akashic Records really are. They're a summation of everything, all the probabilities and all the possibilities that we experienced here. And all I can think of is, if we all know that we're going to die and sometimes make that journey. And I have seen so many people confused and worried and upset and anxious. If we can experience what that's like to cross over beyond our perception realm now through out of body experiences, why not? Why not prepare?
Right.
Why not learn as much as we can? So when the time comes, we won't be confused. We won't be upset. We won't be worried or going into that with a, when my time comes to go, I don't want to sound, you know, maudlin here or anything, but I'm kind of looking forward to it, you know, because I've seen what's there. I know what I'm going to see. I'm not going to be surprised and upset.
Right.
And I'm looking forward to it. I really am.
Well, I think it's just perception. And this is sort of, I think, you know, my mission or what I've felt called to is, you know, why is it important to do this work is because, one, we kind of have like a soul study. So when you talk about, you know, the Akashic and all the possibilities, you know, we can, when we think of just this lifetime, just this amount of years we have, let's say it is 100 years on this planet in this lifetime, it just seems so finite. And yet our soul, our energy is infinite. It's part of something infinite. And so when you take that into perspective, it's less anxiety producing. Like if, God forbid, right, something were to happen to me tomorrow, or, you know, or when I do go, like, I don't have to fear that because I know that I have a study in this lifetime, and the people who come into my life, the experiences that seem hard, the things that repeat themselves are there for my soul to learn and grow. And it also gives me this sense of, this is what like my soapbox is, helping others to really feel the freedom to be themselves. Like, thank goodness you felt free to shift and journey and do this work out of being a theologian, you know, out of that box into all of this. I mean, thank goodness for people who, you know, break out of this fear of how they will be perceived. When you think of yourself as this big energy that's in this tiny body for this finite period of time, this is like a blip. You're like, I got this. I can do what I want.
Right. Like, right. And when bad things do happen to you, rather than say, oh, woe is me, how could this happen? You could say, wait a minute, this is what I came down here for. This is part of, I didn't come down here just to experience good stuff. Exactly. You know, I experienced everything. We came into a world of duality, and then we're surprised when that duality hits, in the sense that there's good and bad in this world. And it can get pretty discouraging until we start to realize this, it's so much bigger.
Right.
There's something so much bigger involved.
Right.
All this stuff. I turn on the television now and I listen to all the news, and I know it's, I don't want to demean it. And I mean, I don't want to diminish it. It's all important stuff because it affects people's lives, and, mm-hmm. and it's important. But really, next to what we've been talking about, it's really such a small thing.
Yeah, put things in perspective. Well, so on that, you know, if someone wanted to engage in an out-of-body experience and do what you're talking about, like what techniques do you use or recommend for someone to do that?
Well, I'll tell you, in my book, The Quantum Akashic Field, I have developed what I use. It's a six-part, let me see if I can get it right here. It's a six-part series, and that's the second part of the book is really all about this. Step number one, and this sounds kind of silly, you have to make the decision that you want to do this. It has to become important.
Yeah.
Most people put it off or figure I'll you know, work on it when I get a chance. Bill Buhlmann, who I studied with at the Monroe Institute for a while, he wrote a wonderful book called Adventures Out of the Body. Mm-hmm. I think he's the foremost teacher on out-of-body experiences teaching in America today anyway. He is absolutely convinced that anybody, if they want to do a meditation, you know, get into meditating and everything else, mm-hmm. and with that idea of accomplishing an out-of-body experience, he's absolutely convinced that anybody who could spend 30 minutes a day for 30 days will do it.
Yeah.
I wanted to try it, so I did. Uh-huh. And if I had quit at day 28 or 29, I wouldn't be having this conversation with you.
Yeah.
Because it has to become priority in your life. Mm-hmm. It has to be number one. You have to make the decision. And the method that I use involves meditation, and especially hemisync music, which it's all in the book. If people want to do quantum
music, is that by like binaural beats?
Yes. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. The idea is to synchronize the different hemispheres of your brain. Mm-hmm. But you have to make the decision. It has to become important to you. You have to find that time of the day, which is most important. And you just have to stick to it, dare I say, religiously. It has to be there. Once you make the decision that this is what you want, this is the important thing in your life right now, you have to, number two, stick to it. We are creatures who are very easily led astray, led aside. You know, everything else is more important.
Right.
As soon as I check my cell phone, then I'll get to it. You know, right. Soon as I take care of this, then I'll get to it.
Exactly.
The third thing, the step number three, is you have to develop a system. And as I said, with me, the system was finding a time of the day when I could say, this time of the day, I'm doing this. It couldn't be early for me because I'm an early morning person. And mm-hmm. when I wake up, my feet hit the floor and I'm already planning the day, and my mind is too wired, you know, to get it done. I can't do it late at night because I start to meditate and I fall asleep.
Right.
So what I found for me, I don't recommend this for anybody else necessarily, but for me, the time that worked was 3:00 in the morning. I go to bed early at night, and by 3:00 in the morning, I'd have 5 or 6 hours of sleep. So I always woke up anyway. And rather than just sit there and worry and stare at the ceiling, I'd get up, get out of bed, put on the headphones, put on the music, and go meditate. And for me, that was the time I found myself waking up like clockwork, 3:00 in the morning. And that was the system that I used.
Sure.
Fourth thing, anybody who's ever done any kind of meditation realizes the importance of focus. You can't decide what's going to happen or try to guide it. Mm-hmm. To me, I had to let it come to me.
Right.
I can't, especially if I had one particularly vivid out of body experience, and the next day I said, I'm going to want to repeat it. I'm going to try to do it again. Doesn't work that way.
Right.
You have to be open, completely open, receptive, and let it come to you. And when that happens, something will happen. Yes. And that leads to step number five. When something does happen, and I can't describe for you exactly what it's going to be because it's different for everybody. Stay calm. You will have an out-of-body experience, and it will take you by surprise, and you won't be quite ready for it, and you will say, wow, I did it, and you will immediately snap right back into your body. You really have to stay calm and just let it come and be an observer. Try to guide it necessarily. Mm-hmm. The sixth step, it was for me the toughest, and for I'm a writer. And for me, it was the toughest. And that's, believe it or not, keeping a journal.
It's
really important when you have any kind of experience, write it down. Even if nothing happened, write it down. Because we tend to forget these things. Our conscious mind takes over and we will forget an out-of-body experience tomorrow or the next day, just like we forgot last night's dream, you know?
Right.
So keep a journal, write it down, and you'll be surprised. That's why in my Quantum Akashic Field book, I use so much of my own journal in there, writing from my own journals.
Right, yes. Know,
for that purpose.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the system that I use. I've had all kinds of people on broadcasts and radio shows call in and say, yeah, have you had an experience with psychedelics or mushrooms or anything like that? I never have. I've just never done it. I'm not necessarily opposed to it. All I can say is I have no knowledge.
Right.
I've never tried it, never used it, so I don't know. But I know a lot of shamans in indigenous traditions that regularly will use ayahuasca or mushrooms or even some, you know, LSD, that kind of thing, synthetics.
Right.
I'm not judging it. I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying I've never had, so I can't give you any advice.
Yeah, it's interesting. I was talking to a friend of mine recently. He does breath work, and he was talking about breath work providing a similar entry into an out-of-body experiences, these type of shamanic experiences, same as perhaps like an ayahuasca experience, to your point, you know, breath work, or even just these binaural beats, like having, to me, these practices, even for what I teach, being in the intuition field, it's practice and records, recording your experience. Because I remember when I was keeping a dream journal, I look back and I did not recall dreaming that thing at all. It was like I was reading something somebody else had written down.
Yeah.
It was completely foreign.
Yeah. That was the experience I had when I was writing. Practice is everything. Growing up as a musician, when I went to music school, there were a lot of natural musicians who just were like, not like Mozart, but pretty close, so that kind of thing. And then there were a lot of people who just had to work at it. But at the end, practice was the key, you know, and it's the same thing in out-of-body experience. There are some naturals who just will have out-of-body experience and just, you know, they're very live close very to that. Other people probably like me have to just kind of stick to it and keep with it and keep practicing. And it will happen. It will happen.
It's so fascinating because this brings me back to years ago out of college, I was in the Peace Corps in Uganda. And then I went and traveled in India. And I remember going to an ashram and learning yoga. And the other people there, other travelers, like foreigners, would talk about astral travel, out-of-body experiences. And at the time, I just didn't quite, I was like, what are you talking about? But now it's just so interesting to kind of come full circle. But what I'm really curious too about is, you know, just if someone were to start doing this, like, how does it affect your everyday life? I mean, being comfortable with death.
I think it if you're lucky, it takes it over. But it's very difficult. And I live in both worlds right now because it's so difficult. I came out here to the woods to get away from the world and to have time and to slow down and to quiet down, and it worked. So, okay, it was great. I immediately then wanted to write about it, tell everybody else about it.
Mm-hmm.
And in writing about it and talking to other people and lecturing and going out and doing all this stuff, I got right back involved with the world again in another way. And the more I did it, the harder it was, you know, to have an out-of-body experience. There is a reason that gurus and rishis and sacred people down through the ages have gone out to the desert or up in the mountains or into caves to get away from it all.
Renounce everything.
This life makes it very difficult. And this life also is designed to make us so filled up with ourselves. And we all want to, the great Zen story of the student who goes to the teacher and says, you know, teach me what you can. And the teacher says, hold up your cup. And he held up the cup and the teacher starts pouring water into it. And he just pours more and more water until pretty soon the cup is filled and it's overflowing. The guy says, what are you doing? He says, I can't pour water into a cup that's already filled up.
Yeah.
And that was the student. We mm-hmm. get so filled with ourselves and so right. involved in it that, and then we lose that sense of humility and that basic humble self that we need to just calm down and be ourselves. And
yeah, it's that ego, right? And that to me is when we kind of, we do tap into these things and we really understand even more our purpose. We realize, you know, there's a lot in my experience that is being channeled to us. We are being guided towards. And so it kind of takes that ego out a little bit. It's not so much about the accomplishment. It's about like the, mm-hmm. you know, the journey and what it's providing, what it's doing, how it's participating kind of in the experience.
Yeah. And it's hard. In the typical shamanic journey, the purpose of the journey is not for the shaman to have some kind of experience.
Right.
The purpose of the journey is for the shaman to experience the knowledge of what he needs to do to bring back healing or to bring back right. knowledge or to bring back wisdom. Mm-hmm. And if you just go there to have the experience and then you don't bring the wisdom back with you to share,
right.
then it's wasted. Mm-hmm. But if you do bring it back to share and you get really proud of it, that's no good either.
It's not so balancing.
It's just so hard. It's always walking a line. And I don't think anybody has ever gets it perfect, but boy, that doesn't mean we can't keep trying.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, what do you think is the most important revelation that you've taken away from your studies over at least the last decade?
Oh, that we are more than our bodies.
Mm-hmm.
We are much more than our bodies. And the time will come when we'll experience that in its fullness. I love the words of the Apostle Paul. Now we see through a glass darkly, but then we shall see clearly face to face. Now he said, I speak as a child, but when I grew up, I gave away childish things. And we are just beginning to clean that glass and get so we can see through it a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And I was on a radio program the other night when someone said, how do you get to the Akashic field? And all I could say was the Akashic field. You're already in it. You know,
right.
you are right here in it right now.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is that we are so much more than these bodies of ours. And
right.
we just have to come to understand, not only understand it intellectually, but to live it.
Yes.
And when that happens, your life is never the same again.
Oh, it's beautiful. Thank you. Well, as we're sort of bringing this to completion, this is such a pleasure. I would love to talk again with you on all this.
Anytime.
I do have from our book club, a couple of kind of more maybe rapid to the degree they can be rapid fire
okay.
questions that are sort of just going to be, they're not necessarily, they're just sort of not in order. They're kind of random.
Sure.
And I would love to get to them for our book club members. And this mm-hmm. for the Quantum Book Club that I am hosting on a meditation app called Insight Timer. Okay, so you ready?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what should we do to show we're open to our spirit guides? And how do we know when, where, how we actually meet with one and it's not our imagination?
Rapid fire, huh?
Well, like I said, I mean,
you don't have to show your spirit guide you're open. The spirit guide knows. A spirit guide's trying to get in already. So just be open. And what was the last part of the question?
And how do we know when, where, how we actually meet with one and it's not our imagination, kind of like we mentioned earlier.
Yeah. Yeah. You'll know. And when it's happening, you'll know absolutely. And then as soon as you come back, you'll say, was that my imagination?
Yeah.
Yep. But no, it is not your imagination. And yet imagination is a wonderful thing because imagination is that area of our brains, where the probability and possibilities can get through.
Right.
And when that happens, you just know when you're there. And then as soon as you come back, then you almost doubt, everybody does it. You'll come back and you'll say, oh, maybe I just made it up. No, exactly. No, you didn't. And you know it when you're there.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like when you have that gut feeling and then you don't trust it and you're like, oh, I knew that. I knew mm-hmm. that. I knew I shouldn't have done that. Or I knew that was going to happen. You have that gut feel. And the other thing I think about this is this practice. Like the more you practice it, mm-hmm. the more you begin to really recognize like, yeah, that is what that is. Right. Yeah, that's really good. Okay, now please discuss more about the possibility that there's a tear between realms and the implications importance of this.
There's a what between realms?
A tear.
A tear, yes.
Yeah.
Oh, that there were more of them. I used to use an image of the Tao. You picture a circle with the Tao making like the two little fish that are intertwined.
Yeah.
When I was talking about, I used to use it in my first lecture when I was teaching comparative religions. And on one side is the physical, and on one side is the spiritual. And we like to think that that wall, there's a wall separating, but that wall is filled with doors and windows. Mm-hmm. We can look through all the time. And sometimes we're very close, and that's when you may experience what you call that tear. Sometimes it just seems so thick we can't get through. Sometimes seasons of the year or cycles of the moon makes a difference, or sometimes, you know, when the stars align right. But just look for the doors and the windows, and mm-hmm. and sometimes you go through, sometimes you look through, but they're there.
Yeah, that's a good point. I like that. Thank you. Okay. Does the world of fairies, does that exist?
Oh, I think so. Yeah. All those terms that have been down with us as long as there have been humans. We talk about fairies, and we talk about trolls and goblins and angels and spirit guides. And a lot of them, I think, are just different names for the entities that we experience that when we look through the window and we come back and then try to describe it. Yeah, I think, I think for sure it exists.
Yeah. And then she asks, could we connect to particularly that world, the fairy world, and other supposedly mythical worlds intentionally?
I think that's the whole purpose of mm-hmm. out-of-body experiences, to connect with that.
Yeah.
I like to say, you know, people sometimes say, well, what about the bad, you know, you worry about the bad entities. And I love to say, well, I've never had a bad experience. And I never did until I wrote down in my book, Supernatural Gods, that I never had a bad experience and an out-of-body experience. And that night I had a bad experience for the first time. But I think we are protected. I don't think it's anything we have to be afraid of.
I agree.
We're in good hands. And I think our spirit guides, who are much more in tune with that kind of thing, those are real realities, just as real as ours. Only difference is ours is made up out of atoms. Theirs isn't. Ours is solid. Theirs is more different somehow.
Right. Yeah, exactly. What are some tips to, this is the last question here. What are some tips to, quote unquote, turn our radios on, speaking to the idea that our brains are receptors of consciousness?
Yeah. Yeah. Quiet down. I look at my calendar sometimes right now. And if I have a calendar like it used to be, every single day had something that I had to do, that I had to get ready for. Sometimes I look at my calendar now and I realize my first appointment is a week from next month. That's quite a difference, you know. It's hard to quiet, and don't expect to do it, you know, just in a moment. It takes a real solid commitment, and a lot of times people aren't going to understand. For me, it meant moving out in the woods deliberately and getting out here away, just because it was something I had to do before I died. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying that for everybody, because not everybody can do that, but just constantly be thinking. When you go into a doctor's office, I'm amazed. Here's a chance to sit quietly. Instead, people don't. They pull out their iPhones, or they pull out their, you know, this or that, or their computers or their laptops or their tablets, or and you're stopped at a stoplight. And as soon as you've got a red light, so immediately you grab the phone, see if you have any message or something. Uh-huh. Take every opportunity to quiet down, slow down, just sit. Don't turn on the television. Just sit in the chair, leave the television off, and just sit there.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people nowadays are afraid of that.
Right.
What will I do?
Yeah.
Don't do anything. Exactly. Well, what'll I think about? Well, try not to think about anything.
Right.
Just be. I was thinking about that yesterday. I had to go to the grocery store. One of my every week or 10 days, I have to get out and go to the grocery store. So I went out and got in the car and I was driving down the road to the grocery store, which is just very close to us. But I found myself thinking how easy it was for me just to run to the grocery store. In the old days, they had to hitch up the horse and put it on the wagon. And the family got in the back and they quietly went to town and they weren't filled with all the noise and the thing. We just don't do that nowadays. So I think that's probably the most important thing. Just quiet down.
Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, I love it. Well, I just thank you so much for this time with you. It's just such a pleasure.
Well, thank you, Stephanie. It's been great to be with you too. And to all the people who are reading Quantum Akashic Field with you in your book club, I'm hoping to be with you in spirit.
Oh, I know you are. Absolutely. We'll come for another round when after we've had some discussions on the book.
Super. Love to. Anytime.
All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you.